subject to forfeiting your right to be present, where you will give the closing argument from the other courtroom. And if you continue in a blatant disregard of the requirement that you not reference in any way jury nullification.
What?
He's so stoic looking. You know, he's got a serious face on.
It's like he's actually thinking about something right now.
For the first time.
He may make that final determination outside
mentally
the
preparing.
Preparing for his next objection.
Today, Your Honor.
Yeah, which is right now.
All right, with that, let's bring the jury out.
For the record, may I respectfully request the
black guy behind him?
Yeah.
That's, that guy's name is like Jay Prince. He is actually a Daryl Brooks defender. You know the article that I posted about, like, the lady who thought that Brooks was innocent? He has the same take. Like, he thinks because he's black, it's all just, like, a big cover-up.
Well, he's got to be related to him or something, right?
No, he's like a social media finger. He's got a YouTube channel and all that. I saw a video where he was on with like four other black creators, and they were all like calling him fucking nuts. I mean, he's pulling the Kanye, right? You know, it's just that he wants attention, and it's, you know, good press. All press is good press.
Yeah. He's basically like a social media influencer who's trying to get confirmation bias views.
Yeah, yeah.
That's all that is. That's a nice tie he's got on.
Yeah, I actually liked this. You were right.
That face.
Don't you just want to punch it? He's got a very smackable face.
Yeah, it's hashtag punchable faces.
Yeah, he's got teeth that you just want to knock out. Somebody commented on my video that he had little chiclet teeth. Remember those little gums, the little pieces of gum chiclets? That's what they used to call it in hockey when you get hit in the face and your teeth fall, and they call it spitting chiclets.
Yeah, but chiclets are actually pretty big. Like, remember that scene from Dennis the Menace where Dennis the Menace accidentally breaks the teeth out of his dentures and he replaces them with chiclets?
Fine, Martha. Leave it alone.
Very good. Now, smile.
Yeah, I forgot about that. Damn, man, that's a fucking throwback. The live-action Dennis the Menace movie.
Yeah. pretty off topic.
He put the fucking chiclets in his front teeth. Yeah, that was awesome.
But they were quite large. They're larger than normal teeth.
Yeah.
So maybe more like Tic Tac teeth.
Yeah, the orange ones.
Orange Tic Tacs.
He's like a beaver. He's got orange teeth. Nasty motherfucker. I prefer the smile of a beaver.
Reconsider.
I reject that ruling and take exception to that.
I mean, at least a beaver's breath probably smells better.
Yeah. Yeah. Ruling. I like how he's not standing. He just refuses at this point. He's just like,
for
I don't
record,
care.
May I request a legal or factual basis for your ruling, Your Honor?
Denied.
For the record, may I respectfully request a written judicial finding of facts and conclusion of law on this issue, Your Honor?
Denied.
For the record, may I respectfully move for interlocutory declaratory appeal on this matter?
I'm not the court to address that.
For the record, may I move to stay these proceedings until this instant matter is adjudicated by a court of competent jurisdiction, which this court has no all subject right. matter jurisdiction.
Denied.
Under, based on what law or fact?
For the jury, please.
Based on what law or fact?
Well, now he stands up.
Because I'm going to inform the jury of their power. They deserve to know.
I like that guy's face in the back.
Did he speak? During the victim impact statements?
Who?
The guy in the back right there. Weird face.
I don't know. I didn't watch them all.
Mr. Weird Face.
But isn't he on the side? Isn't this like Daryl's side? Isn't
I don't
that how
think,
it works?
I mean, typically, yes. But I can't imagine he has many supporters. You know? They're probably all victims and people that hate this guy. I can't imagine that he has enough supporters to fill out half of a courtroom.
Well, typically I thought like your family can come to your court case or like even like your extended family.
Oh yeah, they definitely could have. Imagine being his mom and coming to the trial and having everybody fucking glaring at you. Like, you fucking let him out on bail, you bitch. You fucking bitch. It's probably not safe, to be honest. I was surprised nobody fucking took a shot at him throughout this trial. He's such a fucking little turd.
Well, actually, he himself mentioned that his mom couldn't leave the house for a while.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was in this speech or another one.
Yeah.
But yeah, it wouldn't surprise me if, like, on his side there are, like, members of his mom's church or his grandmom's church there to support him, you know?
Like I said, it can't be a comfortable environment. You know, I have to imagine a good 90% of the people in that courtroom are either people that were directly affected by the attacks or people that were hit, you know. I wouldn't go.
Thank you, everyone. Please be seated. Go ahead, Mr. Brooks, your closing argument, please.
Good afternoon. It's been a long day.
Yeah, because of you, man. Sucking his lip.
First off, I'd just like to start by letting you guys know that it's a lot of information that you guys should be privy to, I believe.
I can't stand that he keeps saying this, that, oh, the jury should be privy to all knowledge. Like, he only wants the knowledge that helps him.
Been privy to.
Keep in mind, this was like right after they had a really long argument about how he can't argue jury nullification.
Yeah.
And he just comes right out the gate with the jury nullification spiel.
Yeah, I mean, all that. Sue Opper basically said it. You know what I mean? Like, you know damn well The second they come out here, it's the first thing he is going to say. As if a jury's gonna, you know, I can't remember the last time I heard of a jury nullifying a law. So, like, a jury's gonna start with this guy, of all people? Like, how fucking deluded do you have to be? This guy is such a psychopath. Like, he actually thinks there's a chance. This is like his Hail Mary pass. Like, of all the people that are gonna get nullified laws, you're at the bottom of that list, you fucking psycho. I've heard attorneys say that if there's one thing juries hate, and like the quickest way to get somebody to get a jury to hate your client is to make them feel like you're wasting their time. And he was the fucking commander on wasting people's time. I mean, as much as he's trying to shut it down when they're in the room because he's aware it would hurt their image of him, he physically cannot stop himself at a lot of points. I mean, they saw a fairly big chunk of his fucking tactics. They're going to start with nullification with Darrell Brooks.
Well, he was putting on those tactics in front of them on purpose. You remember how he used to do that? Like, when the jury was coming out, he kept bringing up the all his phony sovereign citizen arguments right in front of them, trying to make it look like this court is a big conspiracy.
Yeah.
that was his ploy.
I'm a persecuted black man, falsely accused. Do what's right. Holy fuck. He really thinks that he's got a shot here.
Yeah, he did.
Your rights and your duties. Being the jury. The fact that you and you alone have the power. Not well-prepared DAs with well-prepared and clearly rehearsed speeches and exhibits and a lot of theatrics.
Theatrics?
Frankly, not.
You mean fucking retard? Well-prepared and theatrical performances? Oh, no, dude, that's called a fucking legal argument. Oh, he's so stupid.
Pictures and evidence and all kinds of theatrics.
Yeah, like they're up there putting on a play. Oh, man, they showed videos of you running over people. Theatrical. Security camera footage. What the fuck are you talking about? God damn. He's so dumb.
You and you alone have the power. You and you alone decide what is truth and what isn't truth. You should be informed that.
Damn.
Because she knows exactly what he's about to say.
I've said it before. She is the fucking queen of faces, dude. Look at her.
She looks like one of the beasts from Where the Wild Things Are.
She's like pulling a Superman. She's like trying to melt him with her eyes. God damn.
That's well, yeah, he is Bizarro, right? Is that what you said about him in another video?
Bizarro.
Who is you? You have the power to nullify any law that you don't agree with.
Objection. Move to strike. Misstatement.
Sustain.
Objection.
I will strike from the record the last statement made by the defendant. The jury will disregard it.
Which is clearly what I've been saying.
I heard a lot of people say that he didn't realize that the judge was going to be doing sentencing until, like, the very end. And it was, like, the oh shit moment. Like, it was at this moment Darrell Brooks knew he had fucked up.
How could he have not known that?
He didn't know a lot of shit that I was like, how did you not... It would not surprise me at all to find out that's true, that he just thought the jury was going to handle his sentence.
I don't know.
I mean, when he gets convicted, he comes in the next day and his tone is like, it's a complete U-turn. Like, he's all of a sudden way different. He's like begging the judge for stuff, and if it would please the court, if it would please the court, I don't want to interrupt.
I thought he was still pretty disrespectful.
I
see what you're saying though. Like he made an effort to not be a total piece of crap. Yeah.
That was the closest he was ever going to get to being a normal human. All he was capable of is still abrupting frequently, but at least in between being somewhat polite.
The best he could do was just say, with all due respect, in between his disrespectful gestures.
With all due respect, Your Honor, I'm about to say some disrespectful shit.
I believe that not only is it fair, but it's essential that you be privy to all knowledge, not knowledge that certain people feel that you should hear and shouldn't hear, disguised under the color of law. The fact of the matter is, just like I did with my opening statements, I don't have a well-prepared or rehearsed speech. I didn't look in the mirror and say certain points to myself over and over again to make sure I have them right or anything like that.
I'm just going to come here and ramble for the next hour.
To his credit, though, it's pretty good bullshitting, to be honest.
Yeah, I've said that before, man. Like, he's a pretty good public speaker. Like, that last line, like, disguised under color of law, that's, like, considering he's a fucking, like, high school dropout, he's pretty well-spoken. I mean, it's all utter nonsense. Like, it's the ramblings of a madman, clearly, but...
Like, he was that kid that never, like, read the book in English class, but just stood up there and, like, bullshitted on about it for, like, a half hour and got away with it.
Dude, I did that a couple of times in school. Like, gave a book.
He was, like, good old Atticus Finch.
Yeah.
He changed the nation. Just speaking in all these, like, meaningless, like, platitudes. And considering that... Like we were saying before, he's telling the truth when he said he didn't prepare. He didn't do his homework back in his cell.
Well, yeah.
He's completely firing from the hip here.
Just so dumb. Like, of all times you think you might want to prepare a little bit, this is it.
It kind of reminds me of there's a scene from Family Guy where Peter Griffin was giving an opening statement. Do you know what I'm talking about?
I don't think I've seen that.
You take the good, the bad, and there you have my opening statement.
Mr. Griffin, your opening statement, please.
I'm Peter Griffin. Vote for me.
Is that it?
No. This is it. This is life. The one you get should go and have a ball. Because the world don't move to the beat of just one drum. What might be right for you may not be right for some. You take the good, you take the bad, you take them both, and there you have my opening statement. Shit, Ubu, shit. Good dog.
Okay.
Just a bunch of crap.
It reminds me of Michael Scott. He says at one point in the office, he's like, sometimes I just start talking, and I have no idea where I'm going. But I always end up getting to the end. It's like, very good. Well done, sir. Like his sentencing remarks, he probably would have just kept talking all day if the judge hadn't cut him off. He just would have kept going.
Yeah, that was really bizarre, actually. Like, if I tried, I would have ran out of things to say in his position.
Yeah, he has no, sense of anxiety about the whole thing. You know what I mean? He's clearly comfortable in this environment.
It's like he likes to hear himself speak.
His dick gets hard at all his attention. He is fucking loving this.
He thinks what he has to say is really profound.
Yeah.
I've chosen to speak from the heart. In my opening statements, and now I'm going to speak from the heart. What you won't hear me do is argue facts. And the reason you won't hear me argue facts is because I believe that it takes away from what should be recognized. The tragedy of this event, it should be recognized. Trying to argue facts of this, facts of that, I'm not gonna waste your time doing that. It's a little emotional. I apologize for the long pause.
Always has to announce when he's getting emotional.
It's hard to keep everything together emotionally.
I'm sorry?
He's just fucking sucking on his lip more. It's like his go-to is he look up at the ceiling or start sucking his lip by time.
And getting his lip all wet and it's all gross looking.
Yeah, he must have had chapped to shit lips in the wintertime. All cut up and bleeding. Gross.
And honestly, I don't believe that I have any more tears left. It's been a hard year. For the families, mostly. And that should not be lost on anyone. It shouldn't be taken away. I said it before and I'll say it again. It's a lot of people that are healing, that are attempting to heal.
The implication being like there shouldn't be a focus on the victims? Like, what is he even saying? This is basically an admission of guilt. Like, you're not going to argue facts that this is a tragedy? That's what a fucking lawyer does. What are you talking about? So dumb.
I'm not going to argue the facts because I can't.
Yeah, really? That's all it comes down to. He's basically saying, like, I have no argument against this.
That opens the door to talk about forgiveness for a little bit. With every healing process, there comes a forgiving process. It's not an easy thing for anyone. What you've been hearing from the prosecution, and not to take anything away from them, but let's call it what it is. You've been hearing a lot of rerunning. Same things over and over and over. No different than when you turn on the radio and you first hear that song that you don't like when you first hear it. But they play it so much that eventually you start saying it, the words to yourself before you even realize it.
Kind of like somebody coming into court every day pretending to be somebody else or making frivolous arguments against subject matter jurisdiction. You mean kind of like that? I hate that too, Darrell. With a loathsome, fiery fucking passion. Like, he was the repeater. What is he talking about? He said the same shit every fucking day. He made, like, objection hearsay after every fucking question.
Actually, right before this closing argument began, or he had that same sheet of paper where he drilled off the same, can I find a legal finding of fact?
Yeah. It's all just a script he's repeating.
Yeah.
I hate that song. Why am I singing? That's what's been happening. Rerun. Over and over and over and over and over and over and over. attempting to make things stick in your head that simply aren't true.
They aren't saying the same thing over and over. They're going through all the victims you hit. Like, they're all separate and different people, dude. I know it probably feels that way to somebody who couldn't and chooses not to care, but that's the extent of your crimes, Darrell. They're not repeating the same thing over and over. These are all different people you ran over. Oh, the only person repeating anything around here is you.
Why do I say? What am I saying?
Who knows?
I say, look at the testimony. You know, the thing from the prosecution here has been intent. We all know what's been said. We all know the picture that's been painted. Yeah. Even the prosecution said themselves. How can you look in somebody's head and say, this is what they intended to do? You know, for a year I've sat and gone through this. Feeling so powerless. You know, letting other people run with the narratives. Sitting back helpless while other people paint a picture that has zero truth. Zero. I understand about healing myself, tragedy, pain, all that. A lot of it, there's no need to get into. I myself in my own life have had to do a lot of healing.
Now he starts crying. He's talking about himself.
I find it hard to believe.
Where the Vicks Vapor Rub is finally kicking in.
Yeah.
It's finally melting.
I heard an actress say the other day that there's like a cry stick.
Had conversations when he spent time around me.
A cry stick.
Yeah, it's like it got toxins in it or something. It makes people cry.
One second.
You, like, stick it in your nose?
That this is an intentional act. I've never heard of someone intentionally trying to hurt someone while attempting to blow their horn. While attempting to alert people of their presence. Which brings me to more information that I believe that you should have been privy to. And I'm sure that the prosecution will beg to differ. But the fact of the matter is,
you know what's funny about this? If he really wanted to sell, like hard sell this idea that the throttle body malfunctioned and it was an accident, he was honking to get people out of the way, he could have testified to that.
Yeah.
But he purposely acted up because he didn't want to be on the stand trying to make an argument for it.
Yeah. I think he knows there's no shot that he's getting off. You know, he was trying to make as many cases for appellate court that he can. That way he can spend more time out of his cell doing that.
I think he wasn't confident that he could keep consistent with the lie when the prosecution was cross-examining him.
Yeah, that's probably a good question, too. Opera probably would have fucking chewed him up.
Yeah, they would have picked his testimony apart.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I'm sure they had a rebuttal for any point he could have tried to make. Man, that would have been fucking sweet to see, though. Him. Oh, God.
But he was smart enough to avoid it.
Yeah.
That's why he only, like, makes the argument from, like, a third-person perspective.
Yeah.
As a third-party intervener.
Yeah, he knew he was going to be able to say whatever the fuck he wanted during closing and sentencing remarks, so what the hell does he need to testify for? At least this way he's not subject to cross.
Yeah.
The vehicle in question, make and model of 2010, Ford Escape. The vehicle in question.
And actually, he didn't even bring up the throttle body until after the prosecution brought it up, isn't that right?
His mom sends him the recall paperwork. She probably was getting phone calls. You know how you get phone calls all the time, like the extended warranty or whatever?
Uh-huh.
She probably got a call and was reminded, like, oh shit, that's right. There's a recall, my baby!
Well, my...
I need this baby!
My understanding was that the prosecution brought someone on to talk about the throttle bodies just to cover it, and he never made mention of it himself until after that happened.
So yeah, they bring a guy in, an inspector, who went through the car, and he specifically makes references in their vehicle inspection report about this recall and how there would be signs that would... You could see after the fact if that's what had happened. Like,
sure, yeah. But what I'm saying is that happened before he even brought up throttle bodies.
Yeah.
Because he heard that and he was like, oh, throttle bodies.
Yeah. They already addressed it, yeah.
Like, he obviously would have said something before.
Yeah.
At some point.
Yeah. They basically shut it right down as soon as he brings it up. Basie just, you know, they go to the state for comments, and she just basically debunks the whole theory and then just says it's a moot issue. Because it is.
Actually, 2008, 2009, and 2010 of that model was in fact recalled.
Objection, misstatement of the facts. Facts not in evidence.
Was in fact.
Improper argument, Your Honor.
Sustained.
Was in fact recalled, was in fact a class action lawsuit against Ford.
Objection.
For those models, for those model vehicles.
Sustained. The jury will disregard.
Information
that breaks either. He still could have stopped.
You should have been privy to. That you weren't allowed to be privy to. Why? I don't know. That information. Malfunctioning throttle bodies.
Mr. Brooks, move on.
It's information that you should have been privy to. Vehicles that malfunction and accelerate, not being able to be stopped.
Objection. That is.
Yeah, that's
information.
A complete.
It's information.
That's a complete misrepresentation of the facts. That's not true at all.
Sorry for the interruption.
Even if he had the recall, he still could have stopped. He's lying. It's a bold-faced lie.
Indeed.
Sustained.
How is it a misstatement when I have the information?
Mr. Brooks, move on.
This is information that I feel like you needed to know. You should have known.
Ah, so gross.
Information that was taken away from you. Why? To prove a case?
This is so manipulative.
Information that you definitely should have been privy to.
Think about how guilty the jury would have felt if they actually did you know, nullify a law based on what he's saying right now. They would have basically, they would have set a murderer free on false pretenses. They would have fucking, I can't imagine being on a jury and then feeling like you got swindled after setting somebody go. Because they'd see this after the fact, you know what I mean? The closing argument and what the facts actually were. So deceitful.
It's also interesting, like, when the judge says to strike something from the record, but, like, the jury still heard it.
Yeah, they say you can't unring the bell.
Yeah.
Like, despite the fact that they're telling you to ignore that, it's like, it's you still said it.
Yeah.
DA says the defendant has an utter disregard for human life. Utter disregard for human life. Not realizing that they're talking about
the activist guy left.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. He couldn't take any more.
Yeah.
Of this biased courtroom. He's treating this guy so unfairly. It's like no defense has been treated with so much grace ever in the history of law.
Yeah. It's probably true.
Awesome.
Frustratingly so.
As again, has children. Talking about someone that watched their children come out of the womb and be born into this world, cut the umbilical cord, held them before their mom even did.
He always brings up cutting the umbilical cord. Like, why does he think this is such a, like, wonderful thing?
Yeah, and he left, like, months after the babies were born. Like, it's really, you know... testimony to the fact that he's a piece of shit. And, like, what's he trying to say? Like, because he had kids, he's not capable of being a murderer? Like, what?
It's like, I like how the act of just cutting this biological material is somehow this, like, you know...
He's now got to get a jail free card for the rest of his life because he cut the vocal cord.
It's this divine thing.
Yeah.
Moments that I'll never forget. And yet they say disregard, utter disregard for human life.
He disregarded that life. He fucking ignored that he has kids. Doesn't even pay child support.
They made reference to a rage. As if they were, or if this particular DA was right there, standing right there. As if this DA is a psychiatrist. I said to myself, rage, what do you mean rage? How can you characterize that? How can you have the audacity to diagnose what someone's brain is, where it's at, what it's thinking, why it thinks the way it does. DA makes references to blocks of no one being injured, but then says it's intentional. You add that up with the supposed rage, the supposed intent to harm and kill.
Kill.
And it doesn't doesn't kick in until well within blocks.
How could he have intended to kill some of them when he didn't kill all of them?
I was characterizing
there were no people in the first few blocks either.
In this rage and this anger.
Well, no, I've seen the footage. Like he drives through there for a little while before he starts hitting people.
Hmm.
He did pass quite a few people.
Maybe it just started as him just trying to get away.
Yeah. Very strange.
Right before he gets in the car to go start driving towards the parade, he tells Erica that he's gonna fucking murder her. So, obviously, murder was on his mind.
Yeah. And he just got frustrated, I guess.
Yeah.
Then why weren't people immediately harmed? Why was someone with intent to kill and rage try to alert people of their presence, repeatedly honk their horn? You heard a detective, if you recall, testify that the vehicle that he observed was not only honking his horn, but was not speeding. So where does this rage kick in? Where does this insatiable intent to kill kick in? They speak as someone who's known someone for years. Which brings me back to the vehicle. What if the vehicle couldn't stop because of the malfunction?
Objection, fact, not in evidence.
What if the driver of the vehicle was unable to stop the vehicle?
What if the alleged defendant wasn't even driving? And you couldn't tell because of the tinted windows?
Yep.
What if the defendant was crazy and having some sort of psychotic episode?
What if he was honking his horn? So dumb.
Because of that fact, what if the driver may have panicked? That make the driver a crazed, or not crazed, a rage? Does that make the driver in a rage and intent on killing people? DA played a exhibit 17. You don't see anyone struck in that vehicle. On that exhibit, you don't see anyone struck.
So they found one video where nobody gets struck?
With someone who had this intent to kill.
Heal.
This rage.
It's rage.
As she says.
Talking out of one side of his mouth.
Yeah, that he's intent with angry right now.
Taking the opportunity to
yeah.
hit as many people as they could.
He looks like if he was back in that car, he'd do it again.
Yep. And that fucking bitch!
Reference was made to...
Wouldn't fucking listen!
The... damage. Says this was all caused by bodies, but then later turns around and says hits barricades and other objects. Heard testimony about hearing loud crashes and things of that nature, but the DA wants you to believe that this all came from people. Evidence doesn't support that.
Upper, get her face. What is he doing?
Who? Him?
No, offer. It's like, what do you expect? That was stroke.
So I go back to trying to wrap my head around the thing that's happened in the last year.
About to pass out.
That is interesting. I wonder if maybe she's just focusing really hard and just preparing to object when he brings up phony facts.
Yeah, it's got to be hard at certain points to keep your mouth shut and let somebody, you know, somebody speak the way court is supposed to go. You watch, like, cases of people that represent themselves or have never been through court proceedings, and they can't stop themselves sometimes when they're somebody's testifying to something they just, like, can't handle, and they just, you know, blurt out, "That's not true, that's a lie!" It's like, it takes a lot of, like, willpower. You know, people are much more patient than me to sit there and listen to this and just, you know, patiently wait your turn to dispute those facts.
Yeah. And there's some, Eric, there's probably a lot of people out there that can't control it and just yell out.
Yeah.
People whose names rhyme with Meryl Mooks.
Nice.
Praying for those families, praying for the people that tragically lost their life, because that should not be lost either. The fact that there was lives lost.
You're literally arguing for jury nullification. That's what you're asking them to do. You're asking them to forget that fucking people were murdered. What are you talking about? You just made an argument for jury nullification, and now you're saying we shouldn't forget that there were lives lost? Those are contradicting ideals in your own fucking statements. That was like less than, what, 20 minutes ago? God damn.
True. Good point.
And the people have been disregarded. Makes me wonder, does the DA even care about those people?
They're literally the ones fighting for them, you fucking idiot. Does the DA even care about him?
What's the name of the male prosecutor?
Witchow.
Did you see his eyes there? He was looking around like, what?
Yeah, really, it makes no sense. Like, they are literally the ones that are fighting for the victims.
Yeah.
You're asking the jury to ignore them. You're the one who's doing what you're saying right now. God.
Yeah, it's not them that cares about the victims. It's you, Darrell.
Yeah. Yeah. You, Definitely.
You ran them over nice and purdy-like.
My actions were definitely tragic. Definitely a murderer. Definitely a murderer. That doesn't mean you can't let me go.
This was definitely tragic. Trust me, I was there. I saw it firsthand.
You should have seen it. People were flying everywhere. It was crazy. Heard bones pop. I ran over a lady. It was nuts.
I think I hit a couple people in there. Allegedly.
Every day.
Alright, if you guys want to watch part 2 of this, you're going to have to check it out on Nawson's channel. He is the other gentleman I'm recording with in this. I will leave a link in the description, so I encourage you to check that out. It's the same exact thing. It's the other half of Darrell's ridiculous closing statement, so go check that out. Alright, thanks so much for watching. We'll see you in the next one. Alright, bye.